is that the Scotch-Irish pioneer would have gravitated to a sort of a Mecca when he brought his family into Indiana in the years just after the Revolutionary War, because, of course, this is the oldest part of Indiana in many ways, and the Scotch-Irish were forming a real influx into the state in the years about 1800 to 1830 or 40.
U.S. 61, leading into Vincennes. Just another ribbon of highway linking here with there. But U.S. 61 is built upon a much older thoroughfare, known back then as the Buffalo Trace.
For hundreds of years, migrating herds of buffalo had migrated from the prairies of Illinois across Indiana down to the Salt Licks in Kentucky. And over the years, they had trampled down a rather wide path through what would have otherwise been an impassable forest. And about the only way you could get through the woods was to follow this, what was called Buffalo Trace, later called Clark's Trace, because Clark used it. It was also called the Vincennes Trace or the Louisville Trace, depending on, I guess, in which direction you were going.
They went in from to Pennsylvania in 1750, then went to Kentucky at the time of the Years of Blood when the Indians were fighting, and stayed in the fort at Harrodsburg, and then came across the Buffalo Trace in 1803, 50-some of them traveling with other Scotch-Irish families, and it took them 3 months to get from Louisville to Vincennes to take up their Revolutionary War land grants.
3 months to get from Louisville to Vincennes. But once they saw the rich bottomland, the movers knew they had arrived. It was time to stop moving.
The Scotch-Irish were the largest immigrant group of the 18th century, and most of us in Indiana who've been here about 120 years or so, our families, will have a Scotch-Irish ancestor. They populated the Midwest all the way to Arkansas eventually.
Today, Vincennes is proud of its heritage. It's here that you'll find the William Henry Harrison home, preserved as a museum by the Daughters of the American Revolution. And nearby, the George Rogers Clark Memorial tells colorful stories of Revolutionary War and pioneer America. Nancy will always enjoy sharing her stories with readers and friends. But Nancy realizes that sometimes the line between fact and fiction, between myth and history, becomes so hazy it almost disappears.
There's pictures in the house of Harrison meeting Tecumseh in this very room, which he did not do. He met him out under the trees. So it is hard to discriminate between fact and fiction. There are all these stories about the McClures and other pioneers, and myth becomes history and history becomes myth. It is hard to sort it out. But I do include those things in my own books because there are historical fiction. I take the facts and fill them in so that the reader can get involved with the daily life and feel the breadth of this experience without just the dry facts of history. But everything that happens in those books happened to somebody, if it didn't happen to the McClures out here. You can never go too far in the pioneer history of Indiana because everything happened.
A story of such mythic proportions is, of course, not without its darker ironies. Many settlers, as they approached this promised land, probably viewed it from atop this ancient Indian mound just outside of Vincennes, believed to be built by the Hopewell Indians. It sits as a silent shrine to the forgotten and vanquished.
Indian difficulties were certainly in their minds, and they might have encountered them in 1803, because Indians were not free from the territory, of course, until 1813 or so. So they would have been thinking, we are up here looking at what is ours, but we have not really claimed it because others are here who could threaten our lives, making the claim to their own hunting lands.
Today, old hunting lands are old farmlands. It was an enterprising McClure who fired bricks for the Harrison home in return for some of the finest acres available. Acres which have been in the family for almost 200 years now. This is sacred land for Nancy, the place where she can actually see the corn grow 8 feet tall. This, too, is sacred land. It's the old family cemetery, The place where Nancy Baxter can see that even the mythic journeys of flesh and bone must all come to an end. But the souls of the McClures and the Movers, their souls live on, resurrected by literature and the hard work of a feisty Scotch-Irish relative they never had a chance to meet. I'm still astounded by the fact that it took a family with all their belongings 3 months to travel from Louisville to Vincennes. And just think, the only fast food around were probably darting squirrels or other fleet-footed creatures. Next time you find yourself traveling along Highway 61, try to imagine a herd of buffalo as you breeze along the old Buffalo Trace, slowly making their way from hither to yon.
A gunman stalked into a grocery store and demanded, "Hand over your cash register." The storekeeper hurled the register at the robber, coincidentally knocking him out.
And if you get a special charge out of the coincidental moments in life, then you'll want to stay put. We have a guy who collects life's coincidences coming up after the small town of the week. But now J. Robert Cook takes us down one of the lesser traveled back roads of Indiana to discover what has to be the most unusual general store in the entire state.
Travel down a certain quiet back road in Orange County, Indiana, and you may come across Punkin Center. Or Punkin Center on Tater Road in Orange County, as Ad Gray, the owner and proprietor of the Punkin Center General Store, used to say. Ad started Punkin Center back in 1922 when he purchased $327 worth of groceries to open his general store. Since then, the store has given way to become a museum for the unusual, bizarre, and ordinary things that Ad and his wife, Mabel, have collected over the years.
Ad went off to school to get his teacher's license, and when he didn't get a school, they decided to start a store out here in a two-room log house. And he run it about 10 years before I come down here. He had the truck, and he trucked and hauled anything that needed to be hauled. Mm-hmm. Well, through the years, we'd always when we had loafers, we had something to talk about. And when somebody'd get something different or find something in the old smokehouse or wood house, they'd bring it and then they'd talk about it and we'd hang it up. And it just kind of went from a grocery store into a museum or something for them to talk about and show people how they used to live and how they done.
Museum may not be the correct word for what Ad and Mabel created here. Certainly there is no order or cataloging like in a museum, no sense of purpose or logic. Rather, it's more like your grandparents' attic has gone crazy and is possessing the entire house, garage, and yard. All around, from ceiling to floor, are the treasures that Ad and Mabel have acquired over the years. They range from the ordinary, like Mabel's prized spoon collection, which includes one for nearly every state, president, and even movie star of the 1940s. Then there's Ad's pencil collection, which numbers in the thousands. And license plates, some going back to the first ever issued in Indiana when they were made out of leather. And the only license plate ever issued with a 1 million on it. Next to the store, in an enclosure Ad built himself, you can find horse-drawn sleighs, authentic backwoods stills, and even a 1922 gray automobile that Ad bought some years ago because it has his name on it and because it was made in the year he opened Punkin Center, 1922.
He was busy all the time. He'd have time to sit and talk to somebody, but then if there wasn't nobody, he'd find a job of some kind. Ad was always good at hunting up signs, and he had a good sense of humor. And if anybody come and he thought they weren't going to come in, he'd invite them in because he wanted to get them in here and talk to them. Used to, when Ad was here, he would sit and tell stories that happened back And the grandmothers would bring the young kids to hear the stories. But I'm not very good at telling stories.
Ed Gray passed away a few years ago. But Mabel still keeps the store going on a smaller scale. She still sells soda and candy. A lot of her customers are Amish or are moving into the area now from Pennsylvania. And of course, she still sells strong cheddar cheese from a wheel, cutting it on an old-fashioned revolving knife and stand. But it's not the cheese or candy that most people notice when they stop by Pumpkin Center. It's the collection of things and what Ad did with them. Like the Santa who waved to the visitor in time to drum and bell. Or the mechanical wonder made from the drive mechanism of an old-style barber pole and the assorted plastic figures. Everywhere you look, you discover that what Ad and Mabel have created here is really a work of art in itself. But don't ask about price.
No, I don't sell any of the antique stuff, but it's interesting to see people come and see what they're interested in. You could show some people some things and they wouldn't care, and others would be real interested in. So I like to see them come in and look around and see what they are interested in. Oh, the antique collectors don't stay too long. They find out they can't buy. They too much that's got history to it that they know they ain't going to buy, so they don't stay. Well, I like for people to come so I can sit and visit with them and listen to what they have to say. You learn something every day.
Pumpkin Center is located about 8 miles southeast of Orleans, just a little off State Road 56. If you're in their neighborhood, you might stop by and look in on Mabel and get an eyeful of Ad's handiwork. By the way, don't confuse this one with the other Pumpkin Center in Washington County. And despite what the state maps say, this one is spelled with only one P. Mabel has added did it that way just to be different.
This edition of Across Indiana is brought to you by the town of Eden, Indiana.
Where it all began, Eden. Eden, Indiana, that is. Recently, we came across what we thought at first was heaven on earth, only to find out that we were in a small Indiana town. We were taken by the religious undertone surrounding its name, so naturally, we visited the nearest church. The Reverend Donald Watson told us he's only been in Eden about a year. However, he already considers it paradise. He's not sure about the town's namesake, but has a hunch it came straight from the book he reads to his congregation each and every Sunday. Sure enough, we consulted our handy-dandy Indiana place names, which says that Eden, formerly Lewisburg, is probably a commendatory name influenced by the biblical garden. Eden, Indiana, this week's official small-town sponsor, and Indiana's entry in the book of Genesis. Now, if you'd like to submit a small town for sponsorship, regardless of religious affiliation, then write to Across Indiana in care of WFYI Television, 1401 North Meridian Street, Indianapolis, Indiana, 46202. Remember, Across Indiana is a not-for-profit public television program, and any appearance of blatant corporate sponsorship is purely coincidental.
Across Indiana, sponsored by Red Delicious Eden Brand Apples. Go ahead. Take a bite. It's okay.
And I wanted to take a brief moment to recognize just one of the many storytellers who share their recollections with us through the mail. Got a beautiful letter from one Mary Alice Pretchell of Jasper, Indiana. After the story I did on Quaker Cemeteries aired, it sparked an old memory for her. She says there's an old marker among much newer markers in the Celestine Cemetery near her. Quote, I was a little child when this single marker was explained to me by my mother. I was 7 and I was concerned about this lone marker, overgrown by ivy and honeysuckle, as if no one cared. The man's name was Greener. He died in 1924. At that time, the Catholic Church taught that committing suicide was unforgivable, and the person killing himself was forever lost, in hell or whatever, so therefore could not be buried among or with the other graves. Every November 2nd, All Souls Day, they'd have a procession all around the cemetery. The lone grave southeast of the cemetery was not included. Well, says Mary Alice, they don't teach that now. So if you hear a Catholic say that religion doesn't change, even brags that his stays the same, well, we know different. Mary Alice adds a wonderful postscript. She says the cemetery merely got larger, and now many other markers surround Mr. Greener. He's alone no longer. Now, while that sinks in just for a minute, please also note that there's been a strange religious undertone to much of this week's show. First, the age-old Catholic Protestant turmoil in Ireland kicked off the show. Our small town of the week is Eden. And finally, the wonderful story Mary Alice decided to send us. To be honest, we never really planned it that way. It was just a coincidence. Just a coincidence. How many times have you heard or said that? Of course, we all have those cherished moments of serendipity, those times when things happen at the right time for the right reason. And what a coincidence. Dave Stelk recently met a man who has spent much of his life collecting, that's right, collecting coincidences. How in the world do you collect coincidences? Well, Frank Della Penna knows.
Well, one of the most unusual ones where a girl was buried alive.
Some people collect things. Refrigerator magnets, hubcaps, some people have rock collections. Frank Della Penna is a collector, but he doesn't collect things.
Another unusual coincidence is where a hit-and-run victim is hit by his own car.
Frank collects coincidences, moments captured in time, happenstances, serendipitous events, things you can't put behind a glass case or on the mantle. Like the time a robber entered a store and demanded, hand over the cash.
The storekeeper held a register at the robber, could incidentally knocking him out.
Frank has spent the better part of his 87 years researching and collecting coincidences, events which Webster's defined simply as circumstances fortuitously relating in some way to other events or circumstances. Like the time a doctor telephoned the local furnace repairman who, coincidentally, needed the doctor's services after he broke his leg running to answer the phone. Or the time a toilet paper truck in Australia collided with a row of restrooms. Now that's fortuitous, depending on the situation, of course.
There are so many coincidences, it'd be impossible to elucidate or explain each one thoroughly. But I shall try.
He's cataloged hundreds of them. Frank started his unique collection when he was 14 years old and worked as a page at the Marion County Public Library. Oddly enough, Frank can't really say why he started collecting coincidences.
But it's just a knack that I have for getting them, and I could build my collection up very fast again if I had to.
Before he knew it, Frank was scouring books and periodicals for odd events that have occurred all over the world. He's a native Hoosier, so not so coincidentally, many of Frank's coincidences occurred in Indiana. There's the story of the two barbers in Franklin who have the same name and ran against each other for public office. Or the time a school bus carrying the high school basketball team from Lafayette Catholic passed a school bus carrying the team from Logansport going the other way. Coincidentally, the teams were each traveling to play each other away. Then there are the two Crawfordsville elementary teachers who taught at the same school and were issued identical license plates.
This is an unusual coincidence.
Those are just some of the once-in-a-million long-shot stories Frank's collected through the years. Coincidentally, when Frank married Gertrude, she didn't even know about his unusual hobby.
Oh, I didn't know for years later.
Well, I think that Dad has always been interested in things happening in life that are coincidental, and this was just an area that focused his attention.
Judy Nichols, Frank's daughter, is now a high school teacher and remembers when coincident collecting was a family hobby.
And so whenever my brother or I or mother would read something in the newspaper that was a coincidence, then we would clip it out, give it to Dad. We would read it and enjoy it, and then he'd put it away. And just over the years, I knew the collection was growing, but we never really did anything with it.
Although Frank succeeded in getting some of his coincidences published, nothing really became of Frank's collection. That is, until about 30 years ago. That's when the doctors told Frank he had lung cancer. Privately, they told Gertrude that Frank had not long to live. Frank and Gertrude left for Arizona. She packed the collection of coincidences.
When I took him out to Tucson, and I felt like he needed something to keep him interested, and I took all the coincidences that I could out to him. It was like a medication when he was so ill.
Frank's coincidences literally brought him life. 30 years later, he's still alive. Oh, and what about the doctors who gave Frank 3 months to live? They're dead.
Coincidentally, I am still here.
But they aren't.
But they aren't.
Which kind of leads you to wonder, do coincidences happen for a reason? Are they meant to happen? Well, you might think so if you read Frank's Crime Does Not Pay series. You already heard the one about the robber getting clobbered with the cash register. And how about the Indianapolis police sergeant who happened to come across a car being stolen? Coincidentally, it was his car. Isn't this a case where life exacted justice? Weren't these things meant to happen?
Not necessarily. Most coincidences are just down to earth and real coincidence.
So they weren't meant to happen?
That is a stiff question.
Whether coincidences mean anything is inconsequential, really. But it's nice to know that we have Frank to point them out.
Thanks, Frank.
You're welcome, I'm sure. It's been very nice talking to you.
Do you think it's been a coincidence?
No, but it's been an incident. And I'm happy to have partaken with you.
Funny thing, when Dave asked Frank to tell him about any coincidences that may have happened to him, he couldn't think of one. At least not one worthy of a place in his scrapbook. Now, is that coincidental or just ironic? Well, it's not a coincidence that we're out of time. This happens every week right around here. But guess what? We'll be back next week with another trip across the Hoosier State. I'm Michael Atwood. Hope you can join us then.
If the eastern knobs don't get you with their mountain heights and fogs, horsefly swarms and clouds of gnats will give you fever in the western bog. Oh, the Buffalo Trace. The Buffalo Trace, the promised land is in view. It's heaven when you get there, but it's hell until you do. The winters are cold on the Buffalo Trace. It's so cold at night. Many a brave pioneer has lost their life. On the Buffalo Trace, the Buffalo Trace, the promised land is in view. It's heaven when you get there, but it's hell.
On the next I'll Fly Away.
They say the dragon man coming. He's all dressed up in white. He snatched away, bring you right up. You always hear his dogs first.
Tonight at 8 on TV 39.
Next time on The Nature of Sex. All over the animal kingdom, males and females meet and mate. It could be a brief encounter or an alliance that lasts a lifetime. There's an infinite variety of ways for animals to play the mating game. But what about sex and the human animal? Curious? Of course you are. That's The Nature of Sex.
Tonight at 9.
on TV 39.
Hi, I'm Kurt Miller. Your pledge to TV 39 keeps programs like Primetime 39, the McNeil-Lehrer News Hour, and Washington Week in Review coming your way each week. That kind of in-depth news and issues analysis is available only if you'll pledge your support or continue your support of TV 39.
Send your check to WFWA TV 39, P.O. Box 39, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46801.
You are watching viewer-supported WFWA 39, Fort Wayne. The following program on WFWA TV 39 is available in stereo with closed captions for the hearing impaired.
Previously on I'll Fly Away.
I shouldn't have thought for one second I'd let you keep that hat.
Can we ask the little boy if we can have it?
They pay me for the work I put in. I can't be asking for favors on top. It's not like with friends. They're not my friends.
You agree you attacked the officer?
Not denying he struck Officer Johnsonius. He was acting in self-defense.
Against what?
He was gonna kill me.
He was going to kill you? Why?
Because I looked at him.
If we allow our colored populace to strike a police officer...
Not to mention a white man.
Exactly. Then I tell you, we might as well hand over the keys to the city to them right now.
Gentlemen, I lied in my statement. I beat that Negro, and without probable cause.
Prentice Carberry was killed last night.
Killed?
I gave the order to release him at 5 o'clock. How the hell did it take till 2 a.m.?
Funding for I'll Fly Away is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by annual financial support from viewers like you.
Can too. He's bigger and stronger. If he get a hold of him, he'd kill him dead. But he don't got sharp teeth.
Don't matter none.
Does chew?
Does not.
What are you two fussing about?
You think Wolfman can beat up Frankenstein?
What are they fighting for?
I don't know. They're just fighting.
Well, I guess who's bigger is gonna win. Edward Lane, John Morgan. Would you finish up those peas? I'm about done with you.
Told you so. I bet Frankenstein couldn't be a dragon man.
Who's the dragon man?
Somebody heard my uncle talk about. He's seen him, too.
He has?
Mm-hmm. He said first you hear his dogs barking. And pretty soon, the dragon man will come all dressed in white. Snatch you away, bring you right up, and you will never get seen again. And all you will find in the morning is your shoes and the spot where the grass is all burned up.
Hey.
How's your father doing?
He's better, thank you. I appreciate you letting me bring Adeline till he comes home again.
I don't mind. I know John Morgan enjoys her company.
And Dad, Mama.
Thank you. What do you say?
Hello, Mr. Beckford.
Evening, Adeline. John Morgan, you want to help me carve this jack-o'-lantern? John Morgan?
Yeah, Daddy.
Good night, Miss Beckford.
Good night.
John Morgan?
Good night.
Did your mama carve the eyes or the mouth first?
Opal always did it.
Why don't we carve his eyes out first? Then we'll do the mouth and teeth. Then we'll do the nose.
I have never been afraid of the night. I've always found comfort in it. Even now, there is something in the stillness that satisfies me. Something in the darkness that brings me peace. I've told my daughter this. It's not the dead that do us harm, but the living. It's not the night, but what men do in it that should make us tremble. There is evil in the world, but remember, love is stronger. I've chased the monsters from her room 3 times this week. I expect after tomorrow there'll be fewer of them. And I tell her one day, they will all be gone.
You go now.
Miss Lakitis, I'm Thomas Carver. I don't know if you remember me.
Well, sure I do.
Miss Lakitis, my mother and I, we need your help.
Well, if you need an attorney, just come and see me in my office.
We already been there, ma'am. They wouldn't let us wait inside, so we come here.
What do you want?
We need somebody to make the law go after the men that killed my brother.
Kill?
Oh, no accident. If somebody saw them men run Prentice off the road, saw him get pulled out of the car, saw him get... beat to death of a tire. Saw the whole thing.
Why didn't this person come forward before now?
Afraid to get the kill. They don't even know I'm here.
If you've got a reliable witness, you should go to the police or the district attorney. I'm not the one you should be telling this to.
It's the God's truth, man. The police won't listen to us. They won't.
This is the dumbest pumpkin I ever saw.
John Morgan, get down.
Good morning.
Good morning. Is Nathan coming down?
Yeah, he's coming in a minute. He's shaving his legs.
Shaving what?
Oh, so the tape won't stick. And Dad won't let me shave mine. Can you explain this?
I won't even try.
I heard about the Dragon Man. The Dragon Man?
Sit down before it gets cold.
And he's got these long fingernails that he pokes out your eyeballs with. And then he uses his fire to roast your guts. And he eats everything except your shoes.
Wow.
Excuse me, but is this really something we need to be talking about at my breakfast?
Tell me the part about the blood.
Don't you dare.
Ollie, don't your parents ever feed you?
Yeah, this morning.
So, John Morgan, what are you going to be this year?
I don't know.
I was going to be Davy Crockett, but I'm going to be a pirate.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So what do you all think?
Dad, I don't have a costume. After school, can we go get one?
I have to campaign at the mill this afternoon. Francie, can you take him?
Well, Harriet Deller finally invited me over to her house to listen to records. I can't miss it.
I can take him.
Really? You wouldn't mind?
No, sir.
Let me give you some money.
John Morgan, close your mouth when you chew.
put it back of it.
Jeez, who did this?
Dad did it. Isn't it great?
Yes, great.
Lily, when you're out this afternoon with John Morgan, would you please pick up another pumpkin?
I'd be glad to.
Somebody forgot the lunchbox. Oh, I'm sorry, Forrest. Did he invite himself to breakfast again?
That's all right, Leland. Go on, get in the car.
How's the campaign going?
Just fine, thank you.
I couldn't get up in front of all those strangers and give speeches and shake all those hands and kiss babies.
Talking part's easy for me. It's sort of like being in court.
Mm. Well, I guess you kind of are trying to get yourself convicted to public office.
Well, it's only a 4-year sentence with plenty of time off for good behavior.
Then you got my vote.
I need every vote I can get.
Well, I better get going. I got a hearing with building and safety this morning, so I'll see y'all later. Bye-bye, Oliver.
Bye, Daddy.
Coming from the steel, I carried some sugar over that morning to start some new bets. I was out back down the river road, and I seen headlights. So I gets off the road. Yeah. There was a car, a tow truck, and another car. The next thing I know, that tow truck done bang that first car off the road. I watched it as it went crashing down through the brush and hits a big tree and stops. There were some white men in the other car, but they stays up on the road.
So they didn't do anything, but they could see what happened.
Yeah, yes. Only one man went down and killed him. Oh, he must have hit him 20 or 30 times. I stopped counting.
Did you identify this man if you saw him again? Would you know him if you saw him again? I'll do what I can, Miss Carver.
Just do right by my boy. Please.
Evidence here to proceed.
Nobody's asking to file charges. I just think what's there in front of you, you want to start asking some questions.
Your eyewitness is a 74-year-old man out for a walk in the woods in the middle of the night. What does he do for a living?
Self-employed.
Christina.
You ordered Prentice Carver removed from custody at 5 o'clock that afternoon. Police didn't let him out of jail until 2 o'clock that morning. And doesn't that make you just the least bit curious? Don't you want to know why there was no autopsy? You don't? Well, then you probably don't care that the pickup truck Willie Smith saw that night was from the Ace Garage. And you sure as hell don't want to hear about that garage being a Klan hangout. For God's sake, Forrest.
What's that supposed to mean?
Nothing.
What is your problem, Christina?
I don't have a problem. Apprentice Carver does. He's dead. I believe murdered. And you won't do diddly squat about it.
You are way out of line.
I don't care. You're just gonna sit there on your butt while the men who killed Prince...
Who the hell do you think you are coming in here telling me how to do my job? How dare you? You have no right to do this. Not you, not anyone. You hear me?
Classical historians tell us the Olympic Games were created as a religious experience. Perhaps to remember the defeat of Kronos by Zeus. But we know that's a lie! That's enough. The Olympian contests were to keep men prepared for one event, for only one thing. What was it?
War!
I can't hear! In war, you've got to gird your loins for the penultimate experience, life or death, victory or defeat. A Herculean challenge awaits us. Mansfield High remains unbowed in their march toward the state finals. But we shall stop it!
Yes, sir!
Where's the next Milo of Croton? Greatest wrestler who ever lived. Champion of 6 Olympian, 7 Pythian, 9 Nemean, and 10 Isthmian Games. The ideal Olympian, a union of mind and spirit and body. Milo could hold a pomegranate in his hand so tightly that no one could open his fist. And yet he could hold it so tenderly that not one little drop of precious juice was squeezed from that delicate fruit. As Homer said, the Olympian is a difficult foe to oppose.
Thank you.
make up your mind, John Morgan. Can't be here all day. Gotta get going.
Try it with the eye patch.
I like this one, Lily.
We'll take it.
It'll be $4.50 plus tax.
I want this one.
Put it back.
Why can't I have it?
Told you not to touch nothing now. Take it off. Right now. Take it off right now. Hang it up.
Yo, oh, oh. Ah. Take that before you walk a plank.
So how you been?
All right. You?
All right, I guess. What are you doing tonight?
Tonight?
Yeah, it's Halloween. You going out?
I don't know. I hadn't thought much about it.
Me either. You want to do something?
Yeah, sure.
All right. I'll pick you up after supper.
All right.
All right.
Don't you feel that in there? Oh, I do believe you've got a gumdrop stuck in your ear.
Look in my ear, Uncle Lake.
I hope you're not finding too much candy.
I do believe I got the last of it.
Doorbell! Come on!
Take it easy. You're going to wear yourselves out.
Trick or treat! Hey, John Morgan.
Is that you, JT?
No, that's Randy.
So what are you?
I'm a beatnik, sir. Thank you, Mr. Bedford.
Daddy, we have to go. Can we go, please? Can we go?
We can't go until Oliver and Mr. Grayson get here.
When will that be?
Pretty soon. Don't worry. There's plenty of Halloween left out there waiting for us.
Okay.
Hey, no running in here.
I got it.
Evening, Francie.
Evening, Mr. Gracie. Come on in.
Hey, Ollie. Daddy, they're here. Come on, let's go.
Mama!
Hey, Lily. Mama!
Still got work to do.
Wait for me, John Morgan.
Where's your bag?
Where's my bag, Mama?
Come here, Adelaine. Come on back in the kitchen.
Mama! need my bag.
Adelaide, come here right now. You can't go with them.
But I wanna go. I wanna go. I wanna go, Mama. I wanna go with John Morgan. I wanna go. I wanna go. I wanna go. No.
I'm sorry. Y'all be careful out there. Don't you let those goblins get you.
Hey, little girl in the black silk stockings. Gee, but you got my heart a-rockin'. Wearing that crazy skin-tight skirt and that crazy goblin shirt. Hey, hey, little girl.
This is the Tilton Sisters.
What's the hurry?
Nathan. He who hesitates is forever horny. Go early, go ugly if you have to, but go for the first thing that moves you. Hey, pretty ladies, what's in the basket?
How you doing, Paul?
We're hanging in there.
Hey, Candy.
Hey, Nathan. What are you all up to?
Oh, nothing much. What do you say you girls come down to the lake with us? Have a little fun, dance stark naked in the moonlight? Okay, well, we'll drop the dancing part. Follow us.
You want a butterscotch?
I'm holding out for a caramel apple.
Oliver was so afraid he wouldn't make friends when we moved here.
Doesn't seem to be the case.
He's a shy boy. I really appreciate you making him feel so welcome in your home.
We're very fond of him.
Well, he sure is fond of John Morgan.
It's a good street, Dad.
Don't run, Oliver. You can't see where you're going.
Okay, Dad. Come on, John Morgan.
I plan on taking Oliver fishing this weekend. Think maybe John Morgan come along just for the day?
You going out in a boat?
No, we fish from the shore. Got plenty of cane poles. Have to dig his own worms, though.
Well, I think he'd really like that. Thank you.
Well, hello, John Morgan. Oliver? You certainly are ferocious-looking pirates. Good evening, Mr. Bedford. Mr. Grayson?
Thank you.
Would you gentlemen care to join us ladies for a cup of my witch's brew?
I'd love to, Iris, but I think John Morgan's out to hit every house in the county for a bedtime. If you don't mind, I'm afraid we'll have to take a rain check.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Another time.
Thanks, Mrs. Grossnickel.
Happy Halloween.
Thanks, Miss Grossnickel. Let's go, John Morgan. Let's go.
My.
Doing. Put that costume back on.
It ain't a costume, it's just a bunch of old rags.
Y'all Mary made this hat. She made the flower, too. The scarf came all the way from Japan. That's pretty special, if you ask me.
Why
why the Bedfords got everything, Mama. Because they're better than us.
They may have better things and seem better off because they have more money. They're not better than you. Nobody is better than Adlaine Harper.
Not even John Morgan?
You listen to me. You are colored. He is white. That does not mean he's better. Maybe John Morgan is as good as you, but not better. No, ma'am. Not better. Nobody gives better hugs than Adlaine Harper. Nobody makes me laugh better than Adlaine Harper. I'm saying. And we don't have to talk about it no more. Now, get dressed. Cousins are waiting for us. And just so you know, you are the most wonderful little girl in the whole world. Always have been, always will be.
Are you sure you gotta go?
Uh-huh. I'd like to stay, but I can't. I don't want to leave you like this. Come on, Marilyn. Mama's gonna kill us if we don't get home.
Take care, ladies, and thanks.
So how far did you get?
Far enough to know that everything was real.
life is too good sometimes. Let's not let anything come between us, okay? Not women, not money, nothing. Okay?
Okay.
Especially not some nigger who thinks he can wrestle.
Okay.
That's a damn good move you put on me. Damn good.
Come on, run. It's about to rain.
Wait
a minute. Let me see. I think you got plenty in that bag. Besides, people are going to bed now. Time we were getting home, too.
Just one more house.
You're dead on your feet right now. It's wet. Come on, let's sit a spell. Come on. What's the matter? Just some old dogs.
They're saying the Dragon Man coming.
Dragon Man? Who's that?
He's all dressed up in white. He snatch you away, burn you right up. You always hear his dogs first. Uncle Harry told me about him.
Oh, yeah. Dragon Man coming, but Uncle Harry's wrong about what he's gonna do.
Dragon Man just loves to
tickle little girls to death.
Why are we stopping? You gotta water the rocks?
This is Coach's house.
We are gonna do it.
Fun last night? Did she get a lot of candy?
Oh, she got a lot of good stuff.
Like what?
Muffins and popcorn balls and crab apples.
No candy?
No.
She can have some of mine.
Well, that'd be right nice of you, John Morgan.
John Morgan, Ollie. You boys want to ride to school, we gotta leave now.
You want some breakfast?
No, I can't eat. Why do you keep asking me?
Did you go trick-or-treating last night?
Oh, you little twit.
I'll be waiting in the car.
This is for Adeline.
Thank you.
Did she stop crying?
Yes, she did. She'll be just fine.
Come on, John Morgan, let's go. Hey, did you hear those dogs last night? Did you see anything out your window?
I heard something scratching on it, trying to get in.
I think I saw the dragon man.
I think I saw him too. Bet he comes back tonight.
Does anyone else have keys to the tow trucks?
Just me and Pat Lowry and Emmett Nash.
Were any of them working that night?
Yeah, Pat was on call. He's the one who pulled that nigger's wreck out of the woods.
And you were at home that night?
That was a Friday night?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sure we was. Because Beth Ann, she wanted to watch This Is Your Life. I wanted to watch the fights. It's a pretty good fight, don't you think?
I thought so. Well, thank you for coming in, Mr. Nelson.
Well, that's it. You don't want to know what I was doing any other nights of the week? Saturday, I take the little lady out. Sunday, that's church night. Monday, me and some of the other boys, we usually go out drinking after work.
You know Prentice Carver?
Forrest? No.
Never met him?
No. Now, on Tuesday, we go to the lodge for chicken dinner.
You still want to go through with this?
Wednesday, I go bowling. Thursday, I see my girlfriend.
Come in.
You sit over there, Mr. Smith.
Would you state your name, please?
Willie Smith.
On the night of September 26, you were walking in the woods near River Road. Is that true?
Yes.
And you saw a man you knew to be Prentice Carver beaten to death by another man. Is that true? And is that man in this room right now the man you saw murder Prentice Carver?
Daddy.
You got a lot of nerve asking me to come here and listen to some of your makeup lies about me. I don't know what kind of crap you're trying to pull, but that's all it is. Bunch of crap.
Call Judge Carraway. I want a warrant issued for his arrest.
You sure about this?
I want to say something to y'all before we work out. If any of you ever has a problem with me, you should have the guts to come and talk about it. Face to face, man to man. You don't have to throw a brick through my window to let me know you got a gripe. The scum bucket that stuck a brick in my living room wall is nothing but a cowardly, chicken-hearted, candy ass. A spineless worm that crawls on his belly in the night. Afraid to stand up like a man. He's not worthy to wear the uniform of a Cherokee warrior. Not worthy to be a part of this team of honorable men. But the piece of crap that did it is sitting here right now. I'd be in fear of my life. I'm gonna find him. May take me a while, but I'm gonna find him. All right, let's dress out.
It was a good Halloween, Daddy. I got lots of candy.
Yes, you did. And you promised to only eat one piece a day, right?
Billy Lee Carter ate all of his at recess and puked at his desk.
No.
Can I be Davy Crockett next year?
You can be whatever you like. Good night, John Morgan.
Daddy, will you make sure all the doors are locked?
Why?
In case the Dragon Man comes tonight.
Who's the Dragon Man?
He comes and snatches you out of your bed, and he burns you up with fire, and then nobody sees you again.
Who told you about this?
Adeline, you won't let him get me, will you?
Listen to me, John Morgan. There's no Dragon Man gonna come get you, or no ghost, or no goblin, or creature gonna come snatch you out of this bed. Because there are no monsters. That's just pretend. Just people dressed up trying to scare us. They're not real, and you haven't got any cause to be afraid. All right? I can tell you truthfully, there haven't been any dragons in Breland County for a long time.
My daughter is a superstitious child.
She believes in signs and hexes. Thinks the old man at the end of the road has an evil eye. She fills her pockets with charms and four-leaf clovers. I don't know where she gets this. I guess it seems the world can be a scary place to walk in. She looks to me for comfort, and I do my best. I wish I could tell her that when you grow up, there's less to fear, that the demons go away and pretty things take their place. I wish I could just say it and make it true. There's so much you can't explain. Things ain't always what they seem. It's a wonder you grew up at all. As I got older, I discovered that all of us got bad things inside trying to get out. But some people don't even try to fight it. They just let it win. I don't know if it's the devil taking over, or it's like the Reverend says, that men choose evil because sometimes it comes all dressed up to look like something else, like something they believe will make them happy. I don't want to lie to my child, but I can't always tell her the truth. Not yet. There are troubles to come. I know this. And so I tell her that we must keep our hearts filled up with love so there won't be any room for fear.
On the next, I'll Fly Away.
You're in this just as much as I am. So don't try and save your skin by selling me out.
Is this about business? Or is it personal?
Of course it is. How could it be otherwise? It starts out that way, it ends that way.
Tell him I said the game is over.
Guard?
Coach, you wanted to see me?
Funding for I'll Fly Away was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by annual financial support from viewers like you.
This is PBS. I'll Fly Away takes you behind the scenes.
Yes?
Mr. Bedford?
That's right.
I'm here for a job.
Come on in.
Want to register to vote?
First, I read the script, and I thought there's something very special about this character. One, because of the journal that she keeps. You hear her voice at the beginning or ending of each episode, and I thought, this is the voice of a poet and a philosopher. I asked myself if there was something I could wish for. Well, when that candle blew out, what I did wish was that all the children could stay as children before they learned to hate or learned to be hated. I think if that happened, after a while, after some years, we'd see heaven on earth.
Can we eat the cake now?
I wanted to bring out who she was as an individual with complexity, what she was like at home,
what she like as one, a woman, as a black woman, how does she interact within the black community, as well as the white community, how does she go back and forth between those two worlds?
Good morning, Mr. Bell.
Good morning, Lily.
The show is centrally about change. Forrest is the kind of character that you hope to get to play, for his complication, for his having a substantial and interesting center. For the fact that his life isn't simple for him, and that the decisions and the things that he has to do aren't simple.
Have I done something wrong, Mr. Bedford?
Are you planning on registering to vote?
I wasn't planning on it, no, sir.
Whether you do or you don't is, of course, your choice, but it's just going to create difficulties.
So it's really the part of it that would seem to be a challenge is actually the thing that makes it fascinating to do and interesting to do.
I've enjoyed working on the show very much because of Sam. He's a wonderful human being to work with. He's very giving.
It's killing you, isn't it?
Because of Bill Cobbs, who plays my dad, there is a sense of family in the actors, in the people on the set, and the people in the office. It's a very rare experience, and it's something that I've cherished.
One of the really great privileges of doing interesting stuff that has a powerful, essential core is that maybe even with an audience member, you find yourself immersed in this stuff. And having the opportunity to work with Bill Cobbs and Catherine Harold and Regina, you spend time with her and you feel you've been improved, and it's really true. She's a wonderful performer. She's got tremendous stuff in her. I think this is just the very beginning of what we're going to see from her. She's a playwright. She's got a lot to say. I think we're going to be hearing from her quite a lot.
There are many episodes that plot out the journey of who Lily is and who she'll become. I thought it was important that she should have a love life. That you see this woman as a woman.
Lily? Want to dance?
Which means that she should have a relationship that has some depth, some meaning, and you see a different side of her in that way.
You know, the great advantage of it showing on public television on a regular basis, week after week at the same time, is that you can watch the novel be played out from beginning to end. But these shows stand alone, too, I think, as really nice little mini-dramas, little short stories on their own.
I think the essence of I'll Fly Away is the retelling of tales, of stories, of what preceded us, so that we can have a sense of where we came from and look forward to the future.